Good evening and welcome to our Monday Thursday service. As we begin, let's begin with the Word of God as it's found in Isaiah chapter 30. This is what the Sovereign Lord, the Holy One of Israel, says: "In repentance and rest is your salvation, in quietness and trust is your strength. The Lord longs to be gracious to you, therefore he will rise up to show you compassion. Blessed are all those who wait for him." This evening, it's rest, it's quietness, and trust that we want to cultivate in our worship together. For the Lord longs to be gracious to us. Let's pray. Father, give to your people as you see fit. We ask for nothing but what you in your love desire to give. We ask for the wisdom to see as you see, that we might see rightly. We ask that you think your thoughts in us, that we may know rightly and know you rightly and intimately. We would live in the world as our Lord Jesus lived in the world, resting in your love and always ready to do the next loving thing. Be with us in our worship. Change our hearts and minds for love's sake and in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you.
Consider with me, if you would please, the events of this evening, this Monday, Thursday. The Gospels record both the preparation and the Last Supper with Jesus. They record the washing of Jesus' disciples' feet by Jesus. They record Judas' betrayal, Jesus' last discourse, one of the longest sermons in the Bible, from chapter 14 to chapter 17 in the Gospel of John. They record his prayer in the garden, his arrest in the garden, the flight of the 11, the denial of Peter, and the arrest and trial before the Sanhedrin. But none of those are really what Maundy Thursday is about. The early church fathers, when they chose an event to remember this evening by, it was Maundy, or Mande, Latin for commandment. So I want to read to you from John's Gospel a couple of passages, one from John 13 and a little bit from John 15. Listen now to the Word of God. A new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. As the Father has loved me, so I love you. Now, remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this, that my joy may be complete and that your joy may be complete. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. On one occasion, the Pharisees will come to Jesus and ask him about the law. And he'll say, the first law is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like unto it, that you should love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets, says Jesus, is fulfilled in these two commands. Are you looking for a way to live, a formula, a central theme for living? There it is. Jesus mentions it again in the Sermon on the Mount. Love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you, that you may be the sons and daughters of your Father in heaven. Be perfect, complete, therefore, as your Father is perfect, complete. That is, loving your enemies, pray for those who persecute you, blessing those who curse you. Paul echoes the same thought. In Corinthians, the Corinthians write him a letter. They want to know about wisdom and knowledge, something deep. What's the deeper wisdom to life? They want to know about spiritual gifts, which ones are desirable, which ones are the most desirable, which ones are the most spiritual. They ask Paul about teachers. Which teachers should we follow? For example, which church or what pastor should we listen to? And then they ask about sexual morality. Which is the holiest way to live? Should we live as chaste people? Is marriage good? Is it better to remain single? Finally, after Paul has addressed all their concerns, listen to what he writes. I will show you a most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy, of mysteries, of knowledge, and faith, that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. The only thing that counts, writes Paul in Galatians, is faith expressing itself in love. The witness of Scripture, Jesus and Paul are united. The law of Christian life is the law of love. Love is the only measure of Christian growth. Love is the only thing that counts. And that is exactly what the early church fathers wanted to underline when they referred to Maundy Thursday, or this Thursday as Maundy Thursday, the Thursday of the new command. Be as upright and moral as we want to be, as religious as the Pharisees. Be as right in your theology as you can be, as Paul, or as religious as you know how. You are nothing, you gain nothing. You fail utterly without love. A new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you. John, that same John who records these words of Jesus in this passage, after an almost a lifetime of thinking about the events of that night and what has happened since in the church, writes these words. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. No one has seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. God is love. Whoever lives in his love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. Whoever loves God must also love his brother. A lifetime to think about these things, and John still dwells primarily, almost exclusively, on the law of love. So when the early church fathers thought through Holy Week and they came to this Thursday evening, and they had a lot to think about, the Lord's Supper, the washing of the disciples' feet, not the least among them, what they chose to put the emphasis on, and I think rightly so, to get at the heart of the matter is everything is seen rightly, only through the eyes of love. They decided that the church would celebrate this day as Maundy Thursday, the new commandment. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. And as John has written, so I leave you. Little children, let us love one another, for love is from God. So we now move to the Lord's Supper. The invitation is to all of you who trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior, been baptized into the faith. Come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. It's a paradox. It's one of the Christian paradoxes. His weakness is made perfect, is complete, or his strength is made complete in our weakness. The first shall be last, the foolish are wise, and those who don't deserve to be at this table are exactly the ones who were invited to this table. Nobody earns a right to be here. We come in trusting him in repentance and trust for him to do in us what we cannot do for ourselves. And he does so much more for us than we can begin to imagine. So, you are invited to this table. On the night of his arrest, Jesus, after giving thanks, took bread and broke it, did with the bread what he would do with his body on the next day, saying, take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and drink of it, all of you. And then he made them this promise. I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of new life in Christ. We thank you that he abides in us and with us through this meal. And that what we do now in our homes, we also do with each other. And it's communion with each other as well as with you. So we pray that you'll bless the elements, bless us with your presence, that we may bless you with our lives. We pray in Christ's name, amen. This is the bread of life. Take and eat, all of you. This is the cup of salvation. Drink of it, all of you. Pray with me. Father, we thank you for this meal shared in the Spirit. I pray that you'll bless everyone listening, everyone watching, with a sense of your peace, your power, your presence. And on this night, when we remember the darkness of Calvary, the agony of Gethsemane, we will live as people marked by the cross and marked by love. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.
Jesus climbed the hill to the garden still. His steps were heavy and slow. Love and a prayer took him there to the place only he could go. Gethsemane, Jesus loves me.
Scripture right now. That's a large part of this service of Tenebrae. And as I do, I hope that you won't try to grasp at what they mean, but just let the Word of God flow over you and receive what He has for you in this evening. I'm going to read three separate passages from Isaiah and three separate passages from Luke that move us through this time. First, from Isaiah. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we could desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and so we held him in contempt. From the Gospel of Luke. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers of the people, and he said to them, "You brought me this man as one who is inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charge against him. Neither is Herod, for he is sinning back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and release him." But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man. Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for insurrection and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? "What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I will have him punished and released." But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So when Pilate decided to grant their demand, he released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. Again, from the prophet Isaiah, "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. That a punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one has turned to her own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." From the Gospel of Luke. "The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, 'He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one.' The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine, vinegar, and said, 'If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself.' There was written notice above him, which read, 'This is the king of the Jews.' One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him, 'Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us.' But the other criminal rebuked him. 'Don't you fear God?' he said. 'Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong.' And then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' Jesus answered him, 'Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" And finally, from the prophet Isaiah, "He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before their shearers are silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth." And these words from Luke. "It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, 'Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.' And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what happened, praised God and said, 'Surely this was a righteous man.' When all the people who were gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all of those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things." And now the benediction, the good word, God's good word over you. It also comes from Isaiah. "Though the Lord give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your eyes shall see your teacher, and you will have a song of light, and you will have gladness of heart. Go in peace and go with God. Amen."